Pitcher gets a chance to warm up before he goes into a ball game.
I see great things in baseball, the poet and sometime journalist Walt Whitman wrote. It's our game, the American game.
My team was the Mittendorf Funeral Home Panthers.
There's something kind of about a kid that's never played baseball.
For many of us, the love of baseball started with this. It came over the public airwaves. It came into our house. It was free. It's where we first heard the voice of baseball. The voice of baseball was a wise voice. It was a voice of metaphors and tall tales and myths. A voice that was always present. A voice that spoke of right and wrong and fairness.
This rule book is very interesting. I never realized it was such an orderly and courteous game.
As much as we defined and created baseball, baseball has defined and created us.
Too high! Mr. McBurney, with God's help, I call him as I see him.
Americans have played baseball for more than 200 years, while they conquered a continent, warred with one another and with enemies abroad, struggled over labor and civil rights and the meaning of freedom.
We play strictly by the rules. The way I see it, we're ambassadors of the game, traveling the land to display its virtues and sing its praises.
This is a baseball story. For all of us, all the people who love baseball, and all the people who own it.
Who owns baseball? Well, that's a great question. I mean, the fans think that they own baseball, but the team owners would say that they do. It's probably a little bit in the middle.
The owners own the teams, and the fans own the traditions, and the fans own the fans bring their love to the game. I don't know if it's, we could call it pure ownership, but I think fans do believe they own the game.
So the fans don't have any ownership on baseball?
Legally, no. You could argue morally they do.
So not only do fans not have ownership, they're paying and paying and paying for a form of false ownership that doesn't exist.
The fans own the memories, and they own the passion for the game.
The team owners clearly have the leverage and the power right now.
The owners own the assets.
The commissioner works for them. He does not work for the fans. He's hired by the owners. He reports to them. So ultimately, the owners are the ones that own baseball.
But fans, in the end, pay for it by being, at the very end of the game, the source of revenue for everything that occurs on sports.
Virtually everybody has a cable television or a satellite or telephone company subscription, so people are paying.
So in the end, fans are really, they're cattle that are bought and sold by ownership.
Once upon a time, there was a land full of baseball people. Good people, who for generations had supported their team. Through the ownership of King O'Malley I, King O'Malley II, King Rupert, and finally, onto King McCourt. And even as different kings came and went, the people of Dodgerland were always there. The fans always remained loyal. They loved and supported their team, no matter who owned it. They were the constant. And their money, their loyalty, had built the team over low those many years. They thought it was theirs. King McCourt had guided the team into the playoffs for 3 years running. Sir Vin was still comforting them on warm summer nights. And there had even been record attendance under King McCourt. The banks were satisfied, we were satisfied. There's no doubt in my mind that he, Frank McCourt, will be a good owner. But alas, all was not well in Dodgerland. The town crier news was warning of dark days ahead. Word spread that King McCourt was looting the team. He was letting the castle crumble. And the Queen was behaving badly with her coach driver. The Town Crier News kept warning that the future of their beloved team was in great peril. The kingdom of Dodgerland was in disarray, and all you had to do was read the Town Crier to know it. The news continued to spread that the king was bad for the inhabitants of Dodgerland. And most of all, he was bad for the game they loved. And the citizens became angry. They demanded a king who cared about the people who made the team what it was. They demanded a king who cared about them. Then one day, as if out of nowhere, King McCord made an announcement. He would vacate the throne. He would relinquish all power to another.
Frank McCourt, the previous owner, ran the team into the ground, bankrupted. The city was devastated.
And thus ended the reign of King McCourt. I want to personally thank all Dodger fans for their patience and loyalty during this trying period. I have said many times that we owed it to them to ensure that the club was being operated properly and would be guided appropriately in the future. Bud Selig. When he left, you were okay. You were like, okay, that's. Were you glad to see him go?
Right, very much so. You know, I felt that, you know, if there was a group that could buy the Dodgers, you know, money wise, you know, that hopefully we'll turn it around.
Dear Dodger fans, as the new owners of the Dodgers, we accept this responsibility with great humility and appreciation. This team is a community treasure. The title of ownership is merely a statement on paper. This team belongs to you. It belongs to everyone who has dared to love Dodger baseball with a passion. Thank you for your love of the game. Thank you for always believing in this team. And thank you for being the best fans in baseball. The Guggenheim Baseball Management Team. Mark Walter, Irvin Johnson, Stan Kasdan, Peter Guber, Todd Boehly, and Bobby Patton. As the Dodgerland citizenry reveled in the happy news, the town crier lauded the arrival of the new leader. The citizens were giddy and grateful for the kind and generous act. They were in awe of the news that New King Guggenheim had paid the heroic and princely sum of $2 billion to save the people of Dodgerland.
So I think fans can be really excited about this. Sort of a dream ownership scenario.
For his $2 billion investment, New King Guggenheim now ruled over several properties of great value. The Dodgerland Palace and all the workers in it. All the property of Dodgerland. The television rights. And the hearts and minds of Dodger fans. But New King Guggenheim was not your typical hero. He was also a savvy businessman. And he, like any savvy businessman, intended to reap the rewards of his courageous purchase. After all, King Guggenheim was not in the business of losing money. He was in the business of maximizing return on investment and maximizing profits.
Whether we like it or not, baseball today, and has been for quite some time, is a business. So the motivation was they saw an opportunity to make some money off of a very successful franchise with a very loyal fan base.
And the goal of any business is to make money. And if taking care of all the fans means increased profits, then baseball will take care of all the fans. And if leaving some fans behind means increased profits, then baseball will leave some fans behind. Taking care of every fan is secondary. Increasing profits is the goal of every single business. The business of baseball is no different. King Guggenheim knew that the Dodger television rights were about to expire, and there would be great profits flowing from these rights. He knew there was value, and he knew that large financial gains were coming his way. King Guggenheim knew that Lord Cableman wanted a product that he could sell for profitable gain. A product that would help him vanquish his competitors while making tremendous profits. but King Guggenheim demanded a very large sum of payment. Lord Cableman made it clear to King Guggenheim that at this price point, for this deal to pencil out, for it to be profitable, many Dodgerland citizens would be banished into the fields of darkness and be blacked out. They both understood that for the deal to make sense, some of the Dodgerland citizenry would be left behind.
Welcome to Dodger Fan Weekly 2014. I'm Adele.
And I'm Annadelle.
And we love the Dodgers.
You know, Magic said when he came aboard, we're going to bring baseball back to the fans. Kasten, he was on the Dodger Channel, and he said if we could take baseball anywhere, talking about Australia, then it's a good thing. But he's taking it away from fans in Los Angeles.
The biggest effect of this Guggenheim-Time Warner deal was taking away free access to watching Dodger games.
That was one of the things that we, you know, heard from readers about was, wait a second, you know, I don't pay for DirecTV or Time Warner Cable or any of these, and now I'm not going to get to see the Dodgers? And so it really was, that was a big part of the contract, was moving everything to cable.
2013, under McCourt, 228,000 people watch Dodger games on
TV. About 225, 228 a game.
In 2014, after Guggenheim and Time Warner Cable cut the deal, about 56,000 people.
56,000 watched the game in 2014. Once the charter homes came on board, now it's about 75,000.
Do we have a problem at all?
Well, if the question is it a problem that Dodger games are not available to most of the fans, I think the answer is yes.
For companies in these deals to increase their profits, they have to leave fans behind.
Right. They have to leave certain fans behind. I mean, they have to leave fans behind who can't afford it.
And Los Angeles actually is unusual in some markets because there's a very large percentage of homes that just get the over-the-air signal. They don't pay for it from a provider such as DirecTV or Time Warner Cable.
A lot of sports fans, especially in Southern California, are, you know, working class, you know, come from, you know, modest means, and paying for cable to watch the Dodgers or to watch sports takes a toll on a family's income.
What number of television homes don't get pay TV? They just get over the air.
I think the most recent figures show that it's nearly a million homes, so it's a very high penetration.
And there are young kids, there are poor people, there are elderly people, but there's a ton of people that love the Dodgers.
Even having cable becomes a luxury spending that they can't afford. Yeah.
Do you feel like when they made the deal, when I say they, I mean Guggenheim, the Dodger owners, and Time Warner Cable, do you feel like they considered this possibility, or at least maybe should have?
They should have.
The Guggenheim group going in didn't have to think about fans. What they thought about was the return on their investment.
You know, from a business standpoint, they probably just thought, hey, this is a heck of a lot of money.
Are poor people valued by Major League Baseball anymore?
You know, that's a great question. I would hope so.
If we agree that baseball is becoming more successful, as evidenced by the amount of money, then, and we agree that it's moving in that direction, then perhaps baseball doesn't need, you know, the smaller dollar.
No, you want your team to be seen. You want your team's games to be accessible to as many people as possible.
At some point in the negotiations between the Dodgers and owners and Guggenheim Baseball, right? And Time Warner Cable, it was decided or agreed that there'd be no more over-the-air free TV.
That was...
What do you think that conversation went like?
How did the conversation between Guggenheim and Time Warner Cable go? Time Warner Cable said, we want the product and we want all of the product. We don't want this to people to be able to access this elsewhere, because if they're able to do that, then the value diminishes for us.
They needed all the games concentrated on one channel to be able to sell it at such a high price.
The Guggenheim group said, you've got enough money in the game, you can have it. I mean, fundamentally, that's what it boiled down to.
sports are becoming more of a cable offering, and that leaves a lot of people out because it's no longer broadcast over the air where everybody has it.
There are enough fans that make this model work that other teams and other regions are going to continue to do it because it's profitable.
The only ones got in the middle, you know, without access to the team that we grew up with, you know, as far as our viewing experience, is that, you know, the fans.
What makes economic sense for one group of people won't for another. TV deals make economic sense for owners and players. They do not make economic sense for low-income baseball fans. The old 76 sign at Dodger Stadium is now a Mercedes-Benz logo. As a businessman, as the owner of a baseball team, if I can make more money catering to high-net-worth fans, then that is what I will do. Corporate boxes, higher ticket prices, higher TV subscription charges. Wealthy fans buy more merchandise. They buy more expensive tickets. They can afford higher cable bills. Low-income fans do not buy high-priced tickets. They cannot afford to pay premium prices to watch baseball live on TV. If it means low-income fans get left behind or even left out, that is how it must be. No more free TV ride for the poor. And certainly no more Dodgers on free over-the-airwaves television.
We're like pawns in this big game of theirs. And we are losing possibly Vince Scully's last year by not being able to watch him on television.
It's our sport. We've created this sport. And it's about protecting that. And it's about protecting it and allowing other generations to see it and share it.
Kasten used the word...
unfortunate?
It's unfortunate that some people aren't going to get to see the Dodgers. But try and say that to the fans that are forgotten.
I have a lot of fond memories of, like I said, watching Fernando, especially when I was a kid in the 80s.
I would love on summer nights to come home and watch. I still remember watching games where big things happened, and I would run to the stadium to write about them.
I have great memories of watching the 1964 World Series on television.
Every game was on TV. I thought, that's just unbelievable. How cool is that? Every summer night, you can watch the games.
I remember the Fernando Valenzuela, you know, sort of, you know, event, you know, it was so magical, you know, that's basically what my first recollections are.
My grandmother did not care about baseball. She didn't after. But for some reason at that time, she kind of forced me to watch the Dodgers and watch Fernando because she thought that he was so important. I'm sure she loved the fact that he was an immigrant and had so much success here in LA.
I remember seeing Mantle's pained look as he swung and missed on a pitch, or when he hit a home run off Barney Schultz.
Baseball is one of those things, like, we can talk about statistics, we can talk about old players, we like the same team, you can tell me about this team, I can tell you about that team. It connects everybody who gets involved.
So I have all these memories. Most of them are from television. I think most people have their memories from television.
It's steeped in Americana. It's steeped in social issues. You know, it's steeped in a lot of different things. And through baseball, you can talk about everything. I mean, Vin talks about everything but baseball some nights, you know, and it's beautiful. And that's one of those things I think we want to hold on to.
Whether you're 10 years old and you're suddenly, you know, besotted with Vince Scully, or you're 75 years old and you've been listening to him since 1959, that is, you know, those are very valid and wonderful things.
The sound of Vince Scully across the front lawns of these LA neighborhoods throughout the summer is just priceless.
It's the soundtrack.
You know, it's like whatever he says is true. You know, we don't have to second guess it. You know, we don't have to question it. We don't even have to think about it twice. We just have to listen.
Huge part of my day, coming home from work and turning on the Dodgers and listening to Vinny. It's a perfect day.
It's just so magical.
And that's all gone. That's all gone. That's just, it's the blackout has really taken not just the Dodgers from us, but it's taken baseball from us.
We too want to get the fans back watching, and I know that you're helping to try and focus the fans on some kind of issue?
Well, I think there's just the general frustration that in these big TV deals, and nobody's looking out for the fans. And, right. And you know, and we pay for it all.
Where do they think all that money comes from? It is us, the consumer, who buys the products from their advertisers. It is us, the taxpayer, who built most of those arenas. It's us, the American citizen, who continues to foot the bill.
It all comes from us.
See,
we're sort of the shareholders.
We feel snubbed.
Yeah, we're sort of the shareholders.
Abused. It's like a bad relationship.
It's a bad relationship. It's an abusive relationship.
It is.
New York, Chicago, San Francisco, despite having lucrative cable television deals, offer 10 to 20 games a year free to the fans on free TV. They sell those games to a local channel. They could do that here.
When Major League Baseball and the LA Dodgers have received so much public subsidization, fans should have a better access to those games, and putting them on broadcast is one way to do that.
But this is a multi-level, multi-layered problem that really draws on things that don't really impact baseball. A lot of it has to do with the state of how the television business is these days. And that's not really the Dodgers' problem, except the Dodgers aren't on TV, so it is their problem.
Well, the truth is, it is a business. So it's a dilemma. It is a dilemma. I love the Dodgers. I love the Dodgers too. I just think someone should think about the fans. All the fans.
Lord Cableman and King Guggenheim both agreed that the $8.3 billion request was a fair price. Surely they both understood that for the numbers to make sense, not only would it be necessary that the free TV Dodger fan citizenry be left behind, but each and every one of Lord Cableman's competitors would have to agree to pay for, and carry, the Dodger channel. But King Guggenheim held firm on his price. So they agreed. The deal was fair, appropriate, and good business. And off into the free market, Lord Cableman went. A funny thing happened on the way to the bank.
You're on Dish. Dish, is that right?
Dish, yes.
So, basically, for this deal to pencil out, every Dish subscriber has to pay that $5, mm-hmm. Dodger fan or not.
Time Warner Cable, in asking other providers to pick up this service, the Dodger Channel, they're asking other providers to charge every single one of their customers about $5?
Yes, and therein lies the rub.
It's quite obvious that, you know, that yes, you know, the Time Warner has to have this X amount of dollars coming in order to be able to make those, you know, those payments to the Dodgers because of the rights.
The Dodgers, when they moved from Frank McCourt to Guggenheim, they created their own station because they knew that the rights would be far more valuable that way.
Okay, we're talking Dodgers baseball 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's a heck of a lot of content, and that's why Sportsnet LA is more than just baseball games.
So tomorrow, this Dodgers home opener is sold out, but still a lot of fans are feeling left out. They don't have Time Warner Cable.
70% of the fan base is not able to watch the Los Angeles Dodgers in Los Angeles on television.
Yeah.
And tonight, Time Warner announcing they are still the only cable system carrying the hometown team.
And this is a travesty that only 30% of the fans can actually partake and watch the Dodgers.
70% of Los Angeles still won't get the games.
All right, so let's go to Lizzie B with more on this big business battle that's leaving a lot of people left out.
Leaving Dodger fans feeling blue is what it's doing. Time Warner blames DirecTV, DirecTV blames Time Warner. It's all about the money. In the meantime, the fans are fuming. Check out the YouTube channel, Dodger Fan Weekly. If I don't have Time Warner Cable, I don't get to see the Dodgers at all. There's no local station for it. There's no other cable channels that have it yet. They're asking too much money for the other cable channels to pick it up. Cox, Fios, UVerse, and Dish, none of them carries the Dodger channel. This game last night was broadcast on what's now called Sportsnet LA, and according to the rating service Nielsen, around 37,000 people watched on TV. 37,000. That's fewer people than will fill Dodger Stadium tomorrow. Maybe it's no surprise that on the eve of the home opener, when everyone's so emotional about their team, the battle between cable TV giants has amped up.
When these disputes have happened in other markets, you always see a big public relations war.
The new network is available to other TV providers. And to help spread the word, the Dodgers and Time Warner Cable have teamed up for a number of promotions, including Dodger Dog giveaways.
The cable company, in this case Time Warner Cable, the distributor, would be taking out huge ads in local papers and on radio saying, hey, we're on your side. We're trying to get you the best possible programming.
Twice a week, fans line up for free Dodger Dogs and to learn more about how they can get the new network.
And on the other end of it, the DirecTV and the other folks who would be the carriers telling customers, we're on your side. We're trying to keep your costs down. Give us a call. We'll explain. We're on your side. Big campaigns. This one, DirecTV really hasn't had to raise a finger, hasn't had to take out an ad. It's a rout. If DirecTV were bleeding a lot of customers over this, they'd be at least trying to persuade people to stick with them and probably would be running some sort of PR campaign. They haven't really had to say a word.
Okay. What if I'm DirecTV and I'm doing business? Mm-hmm. Is it good business for me to buy into the carriage fee that Time Warner Cable is offering me and charge $5 more for each of my viewers?
If you want people to pay extra for just that one channel and the bill keeps going up, you're running the risk that those customers are going to say, you know what, I don't need this anymore.
Why would I, you know, saddle my other subscribers, 1.2 million in this whole region, with this expensive sports channel, which is only going to drive up the costs and put DirecTV at risk for losing more customers?
You've heard for years now that there's going to be what analysts call a tipping point in cable, and not just in sports, that at some point these bills are just going to get so high that you can't keep adding channels and adding channels and adding channels and making people pay for them.
For the purposes of the other pay TV providers in the market, it's too expensive.
If you're a homeowner that, you know, had DirecTV service and the $5 a month, which is, you know, the wholesale price, you'd be paying $60 a year for a channel that you might never watch.
It is possible that there is that no team is worth this amount of money.
The demand for the Dodgers channel wasn't as high as some people thought.
Why this was the time that we hit the tipping point, I think people are still trying to figure out. But the fact is, it looks like we hit it.
Some people will say, you know, I don't want higher cable bills, whatever. Well, what do you say to those people?
We understand there are a lot of people that are not Dodger fans that don't want to pay the extra money. Mm-hmm. So I say their voices need to be heard as well.
The Guggenheim Group and Time Warner Cable felt like the Dodgers were such a big draw that DirecTV and all these other providers would fall into lockstep after a period of negotiation, and that just hasn't happened.
94% of it is paid for by people who don't even want Dodger baseball. People who are not baseball fans and not Dodger fans have to pay for this.
When you look at it, not that many people are actually watching the games. So a couple hundred thousand at most. So it's a very, very valuable product to have, even if the dirty little secret is that not a whole lot of people are watching.
So it is the economic model for sports television. Does that make it right? We'll leave that to you and the viewers. what they didn't bake into their equation was the resistance that they would face from the other pay TV operators who are like experiencing unprecedented sort of pushback from their consumers who are saying, look, we have too many channels. We don't want any more channels, and we want lower bills.
DirecTV, U-verse, Dish said, we're not going to pay that. We're not going to force our subscribers to pay this, and everybody has to pay it. You either get it or you don't, even if you're not a Dodger fan.
It is possible that everybody just overestimated how valuable these rights were.
There's something going on around here that just don't add up.
Consumers have come to understand the tactics of television networks and sports teams to try to extract more out of their wallet for the same team and games they got yesterday for a lot less. Dan York, DirecTV.
The Dodgers could fix this with one stroke of the pen. They can call Time Warner Cable and say, you know what, let's redo the deal at a price that everybody can get our games at. We'll take the loss, we'll share the loss. They could do that today. They won't do it.
Do they lower the price so, you know, DirecTV, you know, agrees to get on board, and will that make their problems go away? Or will it continue like this where you would have to subscribe to a cable company and, you know, pay $100 a month or whatever just to see the Dodgers?
When people say, well, the Dodgers should give back money to make this happen, the Dodgers say, well, wait a second, we did a deal with Time Warner Cable. We said, we get the guaranteed money, we provide the baseball product. Time Warner Cable promised they'd be able to go out and sell this.
But as smart businessmen, as stewards of Dodger fans, did Guggenheim consider the possibility that Time Warner Cable couldn't sell it? And what would that mean for Dodger fans? Or was the bottom line the bottom line?
They got into business with Time Warner, they signed a contract. Do they tell them, let's rewrite the contract so that we're getting less and you're charging less?
And 70% of the fans could see the show.
Right, right, right. But in what business, and maybe I don't know the examples, in what business does that happen? Where you make a deal on a valuable commodity and then you say, you know, it's too expensive for most people, let's roll it back. It's not like a market price, it's not like gas prices, you know.
It's not that it's too expensive for most people. It's that some people can't even get it even if they have the money.
True. True.
So it's not about that.
Yeah, okay, good point, good point.
Time Warner gambled and they paid extraordinarily high fees for this and they're not able to sell it to anybody else. It costs too much.
There's an attempt to make Time Warner Cable the villain here.
Mm-hmm.
Are they?
Well, any company that is the front and center company saying, we need it, you know, we're negotiating with the other companies out here to sell this product, and if the product is overpriced, they're the easy immediate target.
The migration of sports off broadcast TV has created problems. All you have to do is look at Los Angeles, where Time Warner Cable took over the television rights of the LA Dodgers, and what happened? 70% of LA fans could not watch their Dodgers play.
It is an absolute abomination of a deal. And the stunning thing is that it was ever made in the first place.
When they said they cared about the fans, was that true or not?
They all say it's a fan experience.
Right.
It's a fan, we do it for the fan experience.
Right.
What are they doing? What are they doing for fan experience now?
At some point, you're going to have lost generation after generation after generation of potential Dodger fans, and you're going to be looking at an empty castle.
What's really important about Sportsnet LA is that I can continue to connect with our fans.
Lord Cableman was in a bind, but he was also a savvy businessman. He understood that he was now the only game in town, and if the citizens of Dodgerland wanted to see the team they loved, they would have to go through him. As it turned out, some Dodger fan citizens just didn't like Lord Cableman, and many of them were unable to even access Lord Cableman's services. So they said no, no more, enough, to what they considered to be an outrageous offer.
Time Warner Cable and Charter have about 1.8 million homes between the two of them, and that leaves, you know, more than 3 million homes, I guess. Let me do the math here. A little bit less than 3 million homes that do not take service from one of those two providers.
To watch a Dodger game now, you have to be a Time Warner subscriber or recently a Charter subscriber.
That means that they might have to disconnect from DirecTV or Dish or AT&T UVerse, but Time Warner Cable's position is that they have access to the channel.
Well, you could always switch to Time Warner Cable. Yes, I could. I'm lucky enough that I could. Some people can't.
I would sign for Time Warner tomorrow where I live. I have no access. I can't get them.
Other teams do not do this. I mean, I know other teams do have their own stations, but they still put the team on regular TV for enough games that all the fans can see it.
Well, you know, a lot of fans are being left behind. And then there are legions of fans, young potential fans, which are being precluded from watching it, you know, and in effect not developing a love for the game or the Dodgers.
You cannot watch the Dodgers on TV in Los Angeles.
Yeah, I'm about to kick somebody's ass.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
It's a shame.
It doesn't look like it's going to be resolved anytime soon. Well, Vinny's last season is next season.
They're hurting the game. They're driving sports fans away. They're young kids that could be watching baseball right now, and they're just going to lose them.
They're going to be doing everything but watching the Dodgers.
And I think that's a potential effect that, I mean, we don't know what kind of consequence that is going to have on the game, you know, that we're losing fans.
I think it's mattered to Guggenheim in that it's been a problem because the fans have recognized that Guggenheim sold the rights to Time Warner Cable and Guggenheim owns the TV channel. It's not Time Warner Cable, but they're insulated from the problem because And you know, I can't speak for them, but maybe they felt like everyone hates the cable company, so any, you know, backlash should be targeted to the cable company, not the team.
The fans are confused. They don't know if it's Time Warner's fault. They don't know if it's the Dodgers' fault. And when I say the Dodgers, I don't mean the team and the players. I mean the owners.
Yeah, okay.
When the Dodger fans are all over the place looking for people to blame, is DirecTV a reasonable place to ask for help from?
I think from a fan point of view, you're right. That's what the frustration is if there's one party, you know, you can say, if I can get this party on board, we can solve the problem.
Stewardship, the conducting, supervising, or managing of something, especially the careful and responsible management of something entrusted to one's care. DirecTV, would they be considered stewards of Dodger fans?
I'd say they're stewards of their own customers.
Is Time Warner Cable the stewards of Dodger fans?
No.
Is AT&T the stewards of Dodger fans? Fios?
Same answer. I don't
okay.
Even...
You can do yes
yeah.
or no.
Okay.
Fine.
Again, I would say all these companies are stewards of their own customers' experiences.
Is KROQ Communication the stewards of Dodger fans?
No.
Would you say Guggenheim is considered stewards of Dodger fans?
Yes.
Is Guggenheim Partners the stewards of Dodger fans?
They should be.
I put all this on the Dodgers. I don't go to DirecTV and say, I want my Dodgers. You don't go to a Nathan's hot dog stand in a food court. You don't, and if you get a bad hot dog, you don't go to the food court. You don't go to the mall director and say, I want a better Nathan's. You go to the Nathan's manager and say, I want a better hot dog.
It's Guggenheim's responsibility to get to the fans. TWC doesn't own Dodger fans anything.
No,
they only own their TV viewers.
And so the real accountability goes to Guggenheim, well, Mark Walter and
absolutely.
Magic and Kasten, because they made this deal knowing that 70% of the people couldn't watch it, assuming that 70% would just buy into it.
And Time Warner Cable was wondering, well, who are they blaming? Who are they blaming? Now it's kind of turned toward the Dodgers.
And that's the owners when you say
that's
the
owners. Guggenheim,
right.
The Guggenheim
the
group. And as one fan put it, it's like they jumped out of the plane without checking their chute, you know.
Oh,
they
perfect.
Just went right after the money.
So I'm sorry, you think the Dodgers were blamed for this?
Not the Dodger team, the Guggenheim group.
They should come clean and say, you know, we knew. we were hoping it wouldn't come to that, but we knew it was a possibility. And they're claiming they had no earthly idea.
They wanted this big TV deal without considering what might happen to the fans.
Absolutely.
It's really hurting the brand, I think. It's
ridiculous.
Who do you think is responsible for the TV mess that's going on with the Dodgers? Well, ultimately, it's the Guggenheim people. It's the owners, it's Magic, it's Kasten, it's Mark Walter.
They were in a position to say, you know, if we do the deal this way, these are going to be the consequences.
Right.
And so it doesn't make sense for us to agree to it because our fans will be frozen out. And they didn't do that, you know, and they have whatever it is, 8.5 billion reasons for pretending like they didn't know that.
Right.
While it was a landmark TV deal was made, it's been a landmark debacle now that it hasn't worked. And I think everybody will learn from this. Everybody will point to say, don't be like L.A. Everybody wants to beat L.A. Well, nobody wants to be like L.A. right now in terms of the TV deal.
Who do you think should be fixing the problem? The same people that got us into the problem.
Yeah.
If I want my Dodgers, which I do and everybody in L.A. does, you got to go to the Dodgers. This is begins and could end with the Dodgers.
And as time passed, many citizens of Dodgerland lost contact with the team and game they so loved. And Dodgerland was not such a happy place. This is not at all what the citizens of Dodgerland expected when King Guggenheim saved them from evil King McCourt. Now, over half of them were relegated to the darkness, unable to watch the team that they and their forefathers built and loved. But all was not lost. Surely they could go to King Guggenheim for guidance. Surely he could fix it. He even said he cared about the citizens of Dodgerland. He said they owned the Dodgers, and he was the one who saved them from the tyranny, greed, and manipulation of evil King McCourt. King Guggenheim would certainly do something. But, alas, King Guggenheim was silent.
In this case, the Dodgers own the channel, and they get the money. There's no risk at all on the part of the Dodgers.
Dodger ownership gets their money irregardless of whether Time Warner makes deals with the other 70% that doesn't have the games.
You know, that is the problem. Time Warner Cable agreed to guarantee the amount even if they didn't get other providers to sign on.
The Dodgers, again, they made the deal with Time Warner. Does that make them a party to blame? Again, it gets back to what we were saying earlier. Do you not take advantage of the market when the market is hot?
They got their money before the fans even had a chance to deal with getting the Dodgers on TV at all, right? Time Warner paid them, so the fans didn't matter at that point. So it's not, in this case, about taking care of the fans to get the profits. They got their profits ahead of time.
In reality, I don't think that, you know, the ownership group, Dodgers ownership group is, you know, losing any sleep over this, because they got their money. You know, where Time Warner, you know, gets their money back from is not their deal.
It allowed the Guggenheim group to get a lot of money right up front, but with it came this kind of inevitable fate.
For them, it's just another game, a mere business transaction, but for us, it means so much more.
Guggenheim bought the team for $2 billion. They get to keep the property, they get to keep the team, and they license the television rights for $8.35 billion. They basically, just on the television rights alone, turned themselves a $6.35 billion profit. Was that a good deal for Guggenheim?
Well, I mean, the numbers speak for themselves.
Do you not, for your own needs, get the kind of deal that helps you rationalize a $2.1 billion purchase of the team?
Guggenheim comes in, spends $2 billion, and a year later, return on investment, they quadruple that amount of money.
To be honest with you, I'm kind of upset with the Dodgers ownership, you know, because they sold the rights to their broadcast, you know, of the games. They own the channel. And I know that it was a business decision to get that kind of money that they did get, but they haven't done anything from their part to make sure that, you know, the regular fan gets access to that broadcasting.
I think the Dodger ownership has acted in what they thought was the best interest of the team. I don't think they've acted solely in their best financial interest.
When the Yankees started the YES Network, they started it with private equity firms, Goldman Sachs and Providence Equity.
This was a deal made, brokered by the investment people at Guggenheim Baseball.
Well, Guggenheim is it's a financial institution.
Guggenheim is a money management, and they have several different, you know, areas of business.
Their core business is finance.
Their core business is finance, yes.
You know, I don't begrudge people wanting to make a profit. I mean, right. I'm a capitalist. I think that's a good thing. But what grates for me is Guggenheim pretending like they never saw this coming. Like, oh, gee, this is so unfortunate.
Mark Walters says that he looked at the Dodgers not so much as a sports team, but as a media enterprise.
That's clear in how the Dodgers have run the team in the last few years, particularly with the contract with Time Warner Cable.
The Guggenheim guys were really into the Dodgers for less emotional reasons. The Dodgers, he believed, weren't really a baseball team. Instead, they were a media company.
Well, and remember, Guggenheim is in media too. A lot of people think Guggenheim just is sort of this financial world where they do investments and securities and things. They own Dick Clark Productions, they own Billboard, they own The Hollywood Reporter. They have plenty of people in their firm that know the media business.
This has been a good deal for Guggenheim, as their deal is guaranteed. And according to Magic Johnson, the Dodger brand is doing fine. But is this deal good for baseball? Is it good for fans? All of the fans.
So if two out of three Dodgers fans don't have access, what kind of service is that? You know, what kind of carrier? You know, because they haven't done anything to ensure that we are able to have access to the product.
Do you think the fact that they've already received their money, they got their money, it's done.
Right.
It's created a disincentive that on their part to solve the problem?
Sure, because when you have this much money guaranteed to you and somebody says, why don't you make it this much? Yeah, I think that's pretty much a disincentive.
There's only one entity that should this continue into a third, fourth, fifth year that it will do no harm to. Mm-hmm. And that's Guggenheim Partners,
right.
Because they got their money.
Yes.
So
that makes sense.
So, for a lot of Dodger fans,
well, I think they get hurt in the court of public opinion.
When these disputes have happened in other markets, you always see a big public relations war.
Is it an advantage to have a legit Hall of Fame pro as part of the ownership?
Yeah, he wants to win. He's really competitive.
You bleed Dodger blue. I need to get to the money question. Does Vin Scully approve of your book? Nothing else matters, does it?
No, I'm not sure. I haven't.
This is Molly Knight. She wrote the book, The Best Team Money Can Buy. In writing her book, she had unprecedented access to ownership and management.
New ownership group, I'm a huge fan of. I think that they've done wonders. So I think fans can be really excited about this. Sort of a dream ownership scenario. Yes, the new ownership is fantastic. And I don't think...
Nowhere in her book, The Best Team Money Can Buy, does Molly Knight discuss the Dodger television deal and its impact on fans.
These owners are great. They want to win and they want to spend money. And that's all fans can ask for.
If Guggenheim had the chance to do it again and get their $8.35 billion, knowing that 70% of the fans at any given point, and I know that money, that's arguable, but knowing that at least a lot of Dodger fans wouldn't get the channel,
Do you think they'd still do the deal for $8.35 billion?
You know, that's a question you're going to have to ask Guggenheim.
I reached out to Dodger ownership, and I was directed to their PR person, Steve Brenner. He said that the fans of the Dodgers wanted to put the best team on the field, and he was sure Dodger ownership wanted to accomplish that same goal. He's been a longtime publicist with the Dodgers, even through the McCourt years. He said if I wanted to talk about the television problem, I should be talking to the cable companies. Then he said the Dodgers would have no further comment. Guggenheim Partners, a sprawling enterprise that specializes in asset management largely for insurance companies. Insurance companies are designed to be one of the safest places to put your money. Now you've got a whole different animal, an insurance company owned by investment groups and hedge funds. The perception is they're willing to take more risk for a better return. That's always how it works. If it doesn't work, God help everybody. Using insurance money, which is typically supposed to be invested in safe, simple assets, to buy a baseball team, the ultimate toy for the super rich, seems like a lawsuit waiting to happen. Andrew Sorkin, New York Times. In the end, the people of Dodgerland realized that it was not them that King Guggenheim came to save. His interests were not in saving Dodger fans after all. He was interested in turning a profit. And if that meant that some in the kingdom of Dodgerland were to be left behind, so be it. It was out of his hands.
The commissioner views the owners as individual businessmen, businesswomen, who are entitled to make the deals on their own unless they're illegal, unless there's something nefarious going on there.
The Dodgers got $8.35 billion in their deal. Do you have any idea what portion of that Major League Baseball is going to get?
I believe you have to share about 35% of your local income into the revenue sharing pool.
So do you think that maybe this relationship between the league office and the various teams keeps the league from maybe stopping bad deals? If the deal's big enough, it's like the league won't really care because they're going to get a bigger slice of pie.
Well, but the league also makes deals, national deals, that flow back, you know, to each team.
Major League Baseball would be in violation of the antitrust laws if they sold their broadcasting rights nationally as a league-wide consortium.
Because baseball is unique among sports and has an antitrust exemption.
I mean, the antitrust exemption actually would say you don't really need the rules. You can run the sport however you want without, you know, the government oversight that other industries might be subject to.
This goes back to 1922, the Supreme Court decision that baseball was seen as a game, as a sport, and in a sense, a closed club as opposed to a business like any other. And because of that, baseball is exempt from being challenged under antitrust laws.
So a lot of people feel like it isn't a business, but the people who are running the teams definitely see it as a business.
Right, and it's the people who are running the team who get the freedom from the laws, basically, with their antitrust exemption.
Do you think that'll ever change?
It would change only if baseball did something that would anger Congress in such a way that they finally say no more, you're abusing the exemption.
And yes, the Guggenheim group may not care because they may figure in a 5-year span they sell out, and great for them, they made potentially billions of dollars in it. That does not leave the Dodgers in any better shape than if the McCourts had owned them that entire time.
Sports is a multi-billion dollar business in this country. It has a huge effect on the lives of people.
It is an American odyssey that links sons and daughters to fathers and grandfathers. And it reflects a host of age-old American tensions between labor and management, scandal and reform, virtue and corruption.
A public trust isn't based on greed. A public trust is ultimately based on what you can do for the public. But in the end, the product of sport has always been about the self-interest of ownership and about the greed and the wealth of ownership. So it is a kind of a false front to say that sports have ever truly been a public trust. Sports are about making money.
Baseball is my superhero. It can stand up to anything except greed. Do you think it's possible in any way that greed plays a role in these things?
I don't want to sound like a certain former president, but I guess it depends on how you define greed.
I guess I would define greed as taking for me and leaving nothing to others.
Most of all, it is about time and timelessness, speed and grace, failure and loss, imperishable hope, and coming home.
You dropped the ball! How did you drop the ball?
And where is it?
We won!
The only game in which the defense has the ball.
The fact that they're not on TV is really, creating kind of a different levels of fans.
I mean, talking to Dodger fans, they can't all go to Dodger games as a substitute. They're not all going to change their IP address so they can stream the games. They're not all going to do some sort of illegal hookup.
Why should you have to tell the Dodgers what the best interest of the game is? Why can't they know? Why can't the franchise of Jackie Robinson, for God's sakes, know what the best interest of the game is?
There are no good alternatives. There's no good advice to give Dodger fans. Unfortunately.
Knowing what's happened now in the Dodger situation, for in the future for baseball fans, maybe in Chicago or San Francisco, should those ownership entities like in Chicago consider this cautionary tale before they cut a lucrative deal?
I think it's absolutely a warning shot to any other markets.
For other markets that might start to experience this or have these same kind of cable issues come up, or new ownership coming and promising all these great things, really look at what they're providing.
So for 2 full years, darkness fell over the kingdom of Dodgerland. Even to this day, many in the kingdom of Dodgerland are left without the team they love. And many were left to wonder if evil King McCourt was really so evil after all. Some say the plight of Dodgerland was all for naught. Others said that word spread throughout the land and the people stood up for the game they loved. And their fellow man. And their fellow fan. And so the story goes.